named Dean McDonald. I'm linked to Sunday League, play for FC Rose. Previous professional clubs, came through the academy at Arsenal. After that, where did I go? Ipswich, Gillingham, played a bit of non-league with Farnborough and Dulwich Hamlet.
Owen Price, linked to Portland, played for them for the last year and a half. Previous clubs were come through the academy at Charlton, then Tottenham. Then played abroad in Sweden, Finland. Then come back over and played in non-league at Farnborough and about 50 other clubs.
My name is Jordan Hibbert. I'm linked to Sunday League football through Lambeth All Stars. Shout out LA, come on. previous clubs, I come through Chelsea Academy as an Arsenal first, went to Chelsea. And previous clubs have been Chelsea Football Club, Barnsley Football Club, Queen's Park Rangers, Sporting Club Ferenc in Portugal, AFC United in Sweden, Dulwich Hamlet non-league, Carl Shorten. The non-league list is just long, so just Dulwich and Carl Shorten, leave like that.
Gentlemen, thank you for your intros. Thank you for your time. Big episode today. I think that having you three on the podcast today is really important about the message we're trying to get out and what we're going to talk about. We won't reveal too much until we embracing conversation. Obviously, all three of you have a similar sort of story. You've been through an academy, you've been through the pro game, and then you fell in love with Sunday League, fall back in love with the game. So what we want to talk about today is the academy route. What is an academy? What's it like to play for an academy? Your experience of academy. Do academies do enough? Without trying to tarnish people and tarnish names, it's just our own opinions on whether do academies do enough for young people to succeed? Is the pressure on the young person to succeed, or do the club have a duty of care to help you succeed as well? Good to go. Good to How's go. Everyone's Friday been? Everyone been all right?
Been good, man.
Good. So let's get started. Let's start with Pricey. You touched on previous clubs there. Started at Charlton. What was life like at Charlton?
Charlton was good. It was that was probably my first experience of a professional club. Because I come from a Sunday team.
Okay.
So that was probably my
first. Is that how you got scouted? You come from a Sunday side and got scouted from Charlton and things like that. What was that feeling like? How was you approached by Charlton?
They kept coming to games.
Yeah.
Our Sunday team was decent. We won pretty much everything that we was involved in. Mm-hmm. So it kind of, the limelight was on us. So then we had a lot of scouts come and watch. So that's how it happened. And then when I went there, it was like, that was when I first thought, you know what, this is what I want to do.
Okay.
I like football, I love football, but I didn't actually think that it was going to be a thing until I actually went there and I thought, yeah, this is, I belong here kind of thing.
When was your first thought that, I know you just said that, obviously going to Charlton, that's when you realised what you wanted to do. When was that first sort of light bulb moment that actually, I can make a living out of this? Like, this is now, I know you said what you want to do, but when did that become real for you? Like, hang on, this is what I'm doing day in, day out, and I believe this can be me for X amount of time.
I think that was when I left Charlton and signed for Tottenham.
Yeah. Because there was a lot of talk around you around them times, Pricey, wasn't it?
Yeah. That, to be honest, that's when I thought, whether it'd be through people giving me a big head or making me believe my own hype or it was actually real.
Yeah.
But that's when I thought, I can do this. Like, I belong here. Like, this is me.
Can you remember your first day at Charlton going in? Or can you remember your first day at Tottenham?
I remember my first day at Tottenham.
What was that like? What was you feeling?
It was weird. It was like, I belong here, but I was still nervous because I was at Charlton and it's Tottenham, innit? Like this. So it was weird, but after the first session, I was comfortable. Like, this is me.
Let's go, D-Mac and Hibba. Was it the same sort of feel? What was your route into the academy? Go on, Hibba, we'll start with you.
I was playing for Addiscombe Corinthians.
Sunday League?
Sunday League.
So it started with Sunday League and we're back at Sunday League.
Tandridge League, man. We had some ballers in that team. Yeah, you know, Sean Scannell, Andre Blackman. Some ballers, you get me? Yeah. So, and it was literally, to be fair, before that I was at the Brixton Rec, and they were like a feeder club for Arsenal at the time.
Yeah.
Shout out Steadman, shout out Tony. Steadman, you get me? You
know, wow. Yeah.
Legends. So like from there they had put us into Arsenal. So we was training, but it's like cause we weren't quite ready, me and Andre.
Yeah.
It's like they had us training with Jack Wiltshire, and that's age group at the JVC Centre, okay. Which was a year below us. But at the same time, we're still playing Sunday football. So Chelsea just come down, saw us play, and they just kept sending scouts down. So it's kind of like they poached me off of Arsenal a bit.
Okay.
And from there, like, they was picking me up from school, taking me to Stamford Bridge, taking me to Haaland and all that sort of stuff. So
do you know, when you look back now, do you think that was the right way to sort of get you to buy in? Does that make sense?
I think so, because like this was pre Abramovich. Like,
okay.
So it's kind of like I was 12. Yeah. Like, I was 12 at the time, so it's like, for me, I just wanted to play in it.
Yeah.
So Arsenal-Chelsea, for me, obviously Arsenal was the bigger club at the time, but the love Chelsea was shown.
Have they ever been a bigger club than Chelsea?
Who?
No, I'm playing with you, I'm a Chelsea fan. Yeah, right?
Boy, that Untouchables era was mad still.
Are you an Arsenal fan?
Do you know what? I always say I support good football. Oh, but I'm a Chelsea by heart, obviously, because I come through.
Do you remember your first day at Chelsea? Like, your first proper day?
I do, you know, at Harlington.
Wow, so you're at Harlington.
Yeah.
And what was that like for you? What was your feelings, your emotions on that day going in?
I was just gassed. I was excited. Like, I was thinking to myself, Raj, you know what? This, what I see in my head, the dream, this is like, it can actually happen now. Do you know what I'm saying?
And again, the same question I asked Pricey, when was it that you thought as well, you know what? I should. Is there ever that sense of feeling that maybe, when do you realise that you should be there? Did you not ever feel like you know, when you first joined an academy, it's almost like, oh, am I good enough or should I be here? To when actually I'm good enough to be here. Does that make sense?
Mm-hmm.
I think it's when you're training.
Training.
Yeah, and you 100%. Feel like you're playing against people that you think are there.
Yeah.
And then you're joining, you're like there or there.
Okay.
It's like, come on, I'm meant to be here.
For me personally, because I was at Arsenal before, I was coming into Chelsea, so it's like kind of like those players were looking at me like, okay,
yeah, this guy.
Like, you know what I'm saying?
So that's a different kind of pressure. How did you feel about that, knowing that you're coming into a club where players might, you were now the threat because you're coming to take someone's jersey? How did that make you, I can see the smile on your face. Yeah, how did that make you feel? Was that a good feeling for you? Do you think it set you up the best way possible, or was that an added pressure if you're going into a club, now you have to perform? So I'm coming to take your top, but really, can any of you take mine? So starting up here, was that a good place for you to start? Is that where you wanted to be?
It was, because I feel like going in there, obviously, naturally, some of the players are going to be a little bit sort of on edge. Like, and for me, I come from an environment where confrontation was just a normal thing. So I was going in there on a thing like, I don't really care what anybody thinks or whatever.
You lot of food.
I'm coming in for you. Literally, you lot of food. Because I'm saying, like, I don't see any way out of where I'm at other than this. So. Yeah. You man ain't gonna stop me, do you know what I'm saying?
Perfect. D-Mac.
Yes.
Was it similar to these guys? Talk us through how you first got into an academy. Can you remember how it first started? Like that first step of, was it Sunday League as well?
Yeah, Sunday League. I started playing, I was at Dulwich Hamlet as an under 8. My dad used to coach Moonshot.
Yeah.
My older brother's, he's 5 years older than me. Mm-hmm. So I began training with them, etc. Like, so for me, it was always, I wanted to be with the older group. So that bridging that gap into whether it was an academy or whatnot, I felt comfortable getting into it because I had that support from my brother and my dad. Went to Athenley after Dulwich Hamlet. Dean Lodge is probably the biggest name from there. He was at an academy as well. Yeah. Went to QPR, very good player. And we've got a very good relationship now up to this day.
Yeah.
From grassroots, I got picked up by Palace. I went to a soccer school, just a soccer school in, why can I not remember where it's called? In Brixton.
Yeah.
What's that Astro?
Ferndale.
Yeah. So I went Ferndale. Yeah. So I've gone Ferndale, done the community soccer school or whatnot. They've recommended me onto the proper Palace. When I've gone down there, Palace is like, we don't take those type of recommendations.
Do you know what? Sorry just to cut you short. So when you look at sort of like the soccer school, which is obviously the community side of the foundation, there is that persona that, hang on a minute, he goes to a soccer school. There's no way he's academy ready now.
It's arrogant.
That's what I was going to say. Where does that come from?
Because it's almost like, well, why haven't I seen him then? Okay. He can't be that good.
Is that
yeah,
what it is?
Personally, I think it is that. I think it's everyone's on the lookout for the next best thing.
Yeah.
And it's almost like, wow, like, how come I haven't seen? Which, to be honest, at the end of the day, the whole thing speaks for itself. It's a community soccer school.
Because they're not in the hood. That's where the talent is, bro. It's like, come down, have a look. Let's come.
Cool. So again, that first day going into Palace, what was it like? Can you remember your first training session?
My first training session. As I said, I was upset. My dad's gone and spoke to the coach and said, obviously, the child has been recommended on. He's obviously excited to come. Mm. I've trained. From there,
because it was training session. Like, how did you perform?
Do you know what? I can't remember the training session that it was a good training session. Like, from there, it just, after that training session, I ended up signing for Palace.
Okay.
So
all of a sudden, they do take
place. Yeah, I was about to say, so you're no longer the kid from the soccer school.
I'm no longer the kid from the soccer school.
Yeah.
And I ended up signing for Palace. I ended up being there for about 5 years. So from like the age of 9 to 14. Jason Punching was there. He's part of the team at the time. Once again, quality player, quality person.
Mm-hmm.
I've got a good relationship with him now.
Yeah. So, academy life. What the open question, whoever wants to take it first can. What was academy life like? Was academy football, obviously, as a person, you always have this persona of academy and what you feel academy is. What was being part of an academy for you guys? What did that mean to you in your head then to go into an academy? Did it marry up? Everything you thought in your head academy would be, was it that?
Personally, for me, it was one of those cases of, since I was a kid, like literally, I mean, 4 years old, I wanted to be a professional footballer.
Mm-hmm.
Like, just the education that my dad gave me, whether it was like Italian football, etc., like watching Eurosport, Euro goals, all of that type of stuff.
Euro goals. Like, old school,
yeah. Like, Mario Jardel at Porto.
You're showing your age.
Mario Jardel at Porto, bro. So I'm playing in, obviously, under nines, under tens.
Yeah.
And I'm judging my goals on them, so I'm like, right, you lot in Europe, you just got like 40 goals. Like, I'm like, but I got 30. Yeah. Like, you get what I'm trying to say? Like, so it was always like, I wanted to test myself against the best. So I had that that attitude of, I'm going to make it.
Yeah.
And me now going to the next phase, so grassroots to a centre of excellence, onto an academy, it was like, this is where I should be.
Mm. Okay. Pricey, what about you? Was it everything you thought it would be and more?
Yeah. Well, you know what? I think they give you all the tools in terms of like, well, but more so now than they did us, for sure. But I feel like a lot of it is obviously the education, but the other side is when, especially when you're in school and the bragging rights, or not the bragging rights, but I play for like Tottenham, innit.
Yeah.
And when you're in school and you can play football, you're the guy.
Come on,
no one can.
Me and Price went to the same school, by the way. Ennis Bevin. Yeah. Come on, if you know, you know.
You two were the popular kids.
No, he left just literally before I'll come there. Yeah, yeah. I used to hear about him all the time.
So was it you guys or the PE teacher? What was it?
What was it?
Was it you guys or the PE teacher?
For what?
That was obviously, you know, is it the school that made you guys, or was it?
Nah, not the PE teacher.
Oh wow!
Nah, I'm rampant, obviously.
So obviously, academy football for you, Pricey. As I said, was it everything that you thought it would be?
Yeah, but I feel like it's still a gives you not false hope.
I was gonna say, do you not think you, when I say is the academy, I think you thought it would be a more. Do you guys think about the pressures of you think of the glamour of being in an academy, what comes with being in an academy and a football player? But do you, as a youngster, think about the pressures that come with it? Does that ever come into it? Does that make sense? Like, do you think
as
about
you get having, older? Yeah, I think.
But I think joining an academy, I don't think you think about the pressures. I don't think you think about the pressures of life as a kid.
You're too young.
Yeah, you're too young.
You don't even know what they are.
Hey, yeah. But what would you think? Was it everything that you thought it would be?
It was everything I thought it would be and more. Like I said, I was very fortunate. I joined Chelsea, you know, like pre Abramovich.
Yeah.
And, you know, so I saw the whole transition going from Harleton to Cobham.
Yeah.
The whole building of like, just like.
Cobham's crazy, by the way.
It's
the different world, isn't it?
They got like a million pitches. Mm.
Yeah.
I think some teams get minibuses to their pitches and that. It's mad. It's crazy. It's a surreal place to be. But yeah, sorry to cut you short.
Yeah, no, it's gone, man. So like, for me, it was just like, I was just thinking to myself, right, I'm here now. Like, this is my dream. Like, it can actually happen. Like, before that, it was kind of like, you know, you're thinking to yourself, I want it to happen. But when you're there, you're like, okay, it can actually happen now.
I was going to say, is that a key thing? So dreaming about wanting to be part of an academy, and then when you're there, you've got to have that moment where you go, you know what, I'm here now, now I have to perform.
Mm-hmm.
It's not about, oh, it's an academy and being a trial and everything's fluffy. This is business now. Like, if you don't play well, someone's coming to take your top.
Mm-hmm.
So there's got to be that time for you where you go, you know what, now it's about business. I'm here now, I know I'm here, the honeymoon period is finished. Because if I don't perform, I'm being dropped.
I think that's when you go into full-time.
Full-time, yeah?
Yeah, yeah.
Okay, so, we're looking at the agenda. When young people aren't achieving what they're supposed to achieve in academy, so you guys have had a lot of potential in academies, do you think there's too much pressure on these young people to succeed? So having bad games or a catalogue of bad games, do you think that the pressure on these young people is too much then to have to perform? Or was that the case for you guys?
For myself personally, the pressure came from my dad or my mum taking me to football.
Okay.
So, you know, they've got to take their time out from work or my other siblings, etc., to be able to facilitate what is one of my passions.
Yeah.
And for me, it's like, it doesn't matter who it is. Like, if someone's coming to watch me play, and that's how it's been throughout my whole life, there's no way that I'm not performing. It's impossible.
So the pressures were from yourself, not actually the club or the academy. It's your own pressures.
Yeah, it's the own pressures that you place on yourself and your own standards.
Cool. What about you, Price? Being at Tottenham, was there a pressure on you to perform?
Yeah, I felt it bad. Like, because when I first signed, I signed for money.
Yeah, I was gonna say there was a lot of talk around your name at the time.
So when I signed, and it was kind of like it was in around the time when the thing with the goal.
Yeah.
So it was like, especially South London, I felt like I had to do.
Is that still a record now?
Come on, bro.
when I went Bevan, that's one of the first things I heard about, the halfway line thing there.
Oh, you scored for the halfway line?
It's just in my half.
It's just in your half. Okay. So obviously, you come off the back of a big goal and that went viral. Everyone knew about it and things like that. So the pressure, how did you deal with them pressures? As how old was you?
14.
14 years old. Yeah. How do you deal with them pressures of that? Because everyone, even people that don't like football, have seen that go and gone, did you see what this young kid done? Yeah. Do you know what I mean? And where was it?
Highbury.
Mad.
Only Highbury, it's not.
It's only Highbury.
No, it was hard, you know. I'll be honest, it was tough because it was like, I felt like because it was literally a few weeks before that I had signed for Tottenham.
Mm-hmm. So I knew at Tottenham.
Yeah. So I felt like the money on top of the goal was that every time I turned up, I felt like I had to score a hat trick.
Did the
goal
bring arrogance,
Price? Yeah. So that was my shield.
Okay, so there was that error as well. Although it brought pressure, was that a way of you putting up sort of like a defense mechanism?
Yeah, 100%.
Deflect pressure, sort of you bring arrogance to take away that pressure, so it makes you look like you're actually dealing with that pressure when really it's a defense mechanism.
Yeah, like you're not crumbling inside, but you're kind of.
But the crazy thing, when you think about that, you were 14.
Mm.
Was there anything put in place to defend you? Does that make sense?
No.
Nothing at all?
My manager. Like, it was like, get on with it. Yeah. No, it wouldn't even speak about it.
Do you think that's a problem in the game? Do you think, I think when you look at the game now, I think you take someone like Jose Mourinho, he's very good at taking the limelight off his players and making it about him.
Mm-hmm.
So he's classed then as arrogant. It's all about Jose.
He don't care. He'll take that all day long.
But I think, for me, it's very clever. When his team aren't playing well, he takes that criticism on. So his players then can get back to what they do best, get back to basics and start performing well.
But although of his age, he's not a dinosaur, innit? Like, he knows how to handle young players, older players, whatever. He knows how to deal with them.
What about yourself? Do you think there was a massive pressure on yourself? As you said, you came from Arsenal, so it's in terms of stature of clubs at that time, it was probably not a step down, but you're going from a bigger club to a smaller club. So was there a pressure on you to perform?
Naturally, I feel like I felt a pressure because it's like, again, you're there now, innit?
Yeah.
But for me, it was more, I felt, there was a pressure there, but there was a pressure outside of football as well.
Mm-hmm.
Because obviously I grew up on a council estate and whatever. It's like you're looked at as the guy to blow. Like, and it's kind of like, I felt like the whole ends was kind of like, rah, looking at man like, yo, you got a blow sort of thing.
So is the biggest pressure football, or is it outside influences that are the pressure that then you create your own pressure within the game? Does that make sense?
All of it.
All of everything.
It. Because I think when, like, just from listening to you guys talk, a lot of pressures came from, as you said, maybe not yours, Pricey, bagging girls for the halfway line is probably an added pressure in football. But you said, like, your mum and dad taking time out, then pressures come from somewhere else in football. So you have to deal with the pressure of being a prospect, playing in the academy, as well as outside pressures. It's a lot to deal with as a young person. And them times, the player care probably isn't as good as what it is now. And no, in terms of player care has been slated a lot lately in the pro game. So to say that, you've got to sort of commend yourself that you lot have had to deal with a lot yourself. If you now could give any players advice now on how to deal with it, what would it be?
Is remember the things that make you happy. Remember the things that make you relax. And just keep good people around you.
Mm-hmm.
Sometimes, obviously, it's difficult. Everyone comes from different circumstances.
Mm-hmm.
And everyone deals with pressure in a different way. So I think finding the best way to deal with whatever pressure it is, that's the best advice I'll give.
Pricey?
Yeah, I think something along them lines, like, remember why you're doing it. Like, you're doing it for yourself, but your family, because of the sacrifices they've had to make.
Well, I think it's a job, isn't it? Like, I go to work because I have to provide for my family.
Yeah.
If I don't go to work, I can't provide for myself, let alone family. So I think there's a big one.
Yeah.
It is a job. People need to understand it. Although people watch football,
but it's a job outside of a job for your parents. So my mum had to pick me up from Tooting, Bevin, straight from school, all the way up to Chigwell, wait for me where I trained, and take me back home. Yeah. She ain't getting home until what? 11:30?
At night, and then doing it.
That's
another
job. And she's going out for work in the morning.
Yeah.
Do you know what I mean? So that's another pressure that you put on yourself, because you're thinking, listen, I've got to pull up trees here.
Yeah, even so, different pressures. Like, at the time, I'm coming from, say, Elephant and Castle.
Yeah.
I'm travelling, so how old am I? 11, 12. I'm getting to Rutledge. Then from there, I was at Palace at the time. 13, 14, now I signed for Arsenal. I'm getting school about 2-3 days a week. Travelling from Elephant to South Wimbledon to Walthamstow to get picked up to go training. And then I'm probably getting in at like 10 o'clock.
And so you think I'm getting then?
Like 13, 14?
It's a lot, but it's cliche. Is that part and parcel of the job? Is that what it is? Is that how it should be?
No, I don't think at that age, I don't think it should be. Especially public transport, that's...
Tube, and then you think about just in general the different areas you're crossing on that tube and the things that you can potentially come across.
That's
why I think that some clubs though do kind of they do offer the support, because I have to talk from my personal experience. Chelsea used to come to the school, shout out Ray, he used to pick me up and take me up to training until I was sort of age where I could kind of, you know, we just take the train down and whatever, dad would pick me up as well. You know what I mean?
Do we think academies do enough to support? I know if we talk about the modern players and we're talking about current environment, the way the world is at the minute, do we think academies are doing enough to support young people?
Can I answer this one?
Go on.
for me personally, it's like, I feel like academies do a lot for the players, because it's like there's a lot of character building that goes on in that environment.
Yeah.
And it's like you're kind of being coached into being repetitive and all of that every day
without even knowing it.
Do you know what I'm saying? Which is good, because I feel like for me as an adult, that's helped me to be able to carry out routine and all the rest of it. But in terms of, again, personal experience, inner city boys, it's a different kettle of fish. The environment that it is that we grew up in and you face daily, I don't sometimes think the clubs even fully understand. So it's kind of like they might even want
to
do more,
but they
don't know how to. And I think these things have to come into consideration, because if you want the talent, a lot of the talent is in a London, but it's like the things that we face are different to what would be outside of that environment.
What do you guys think about that? Do you think they're doing enough for young people?
I can't speak too much on what's happening inside the academies now, because I'm not inside the academy.
I can only speak
from obviously the experience that I had. But knowing some of the players that are in academies, I feel that some of the similarities based on their workload and based on the type of support they're given, and just different types of skills that sort of probably need to be taught. For instance, someone that's got to make that journey, like who communicates this to the club? Is that your parent? Sorry, is that yourself? Mm-hmm. Like, how do you, whatever the issue is,
yeah,
how do you, you know, bridge that gap to be able to sort that issue out?
Because I think even traveling, only from working at two different clubs, is even traveling in a kit, you're carrying a responsibility
100%.
Of a badge.
Mm-hmm.
So you have to, are you, it's hard, as you said, in a city like London and things like that, coming from the environments that we know everyone comes from, people have never been taught to behave this way. It's not normal to behave a certain way. It's very, especially carrying the weight of a badge now.
Mm.
Do you think they're taught enough on what a badge means? Morals around the bag, what I don't know how to say it, but are they taught about the club's ethics on what that badge means to how they should be taught? Because a lot of these boys wouldn't have been taught how to behave. They do what they want. They're from local estates, they have talent, but they don't know how to use that talent in the right way. A lot of it's raw ability and it's raw talent, and I think sometimes these young people struggle, because when you try and coach raw talent, sometimes that's when the problem comes. Because of structure. Yeah. They've never had that structure before.
I think if you're a commodity, you'll know it. They'll teach you it. Yeah. If you're not, they won't.
Yeah.
That's the bottom line.
Do you think that's how it should be? Is that
no? It's not, morally, it's not right. But it's a business for them. And that's...
And I think that's one of the biggest things now. I think it is football. When you look at football now, is it a sport or is it a business?
Business.
Now it's 100% from a business.
Yeah, from my point of view, it's definitely a business.
Mm-hmm.
You might have been able to think, is it football years and years ago? But... now it's definitely a business.
Money's taken over. Football's a business.
Okay, so let's look at this now. So we'll go back to academy, your playing days. So was you guys released from academies? Or did you go from academy, was you released from one academy, then trial to get into another academy? Or was your progression naturally academy pro?
For me, it was academy pro. I had my pro while I was still in school. Okay. So that was kind of like I was sitting on my lessons doing my GCSEs last year of school saying, right, now I got my pro already, sort of thing, innit?
How did that affect your education?
Well, I got 11 A to C's, so okay. it was a wrap. But within that, I'm not gonna lie. Looking back on myself, I was a little bit arrogant, like, because I knew, like, I'd fall asleep in my lessons or get kicked out on purpose to go kickball in the playground and that. But academically, I could pick things up, so I knew that I was gonna pass my exam. Cool. You know what I'm saying?
What about you? What about you, Pricey? Did you get released from academy, or did you go academy pro?
No, I went academy pro. Okay. Same as you, bro. I was I already had my pro from school.
Mm-hmm.
So to be honest, I didn't want to be in school at all.
Okay.
So I was doing 3 days in school,
mm-hmm.
and 2 days up at Tottenham.
Yeah. Okay.
And I didn't even do my GCSEs.
Did you not though?
No, and the thing is with the school, when I was in school, I wasn't bad. Like, I didn't cause trouble.
Mm-hmm.
I didn't do with authority well, innit? Okay. So I was like, I wasn't really getting on. So they was happy for me to go and do the other 2 days.
Okay.
So I was out of the way.
Okay.
So for me not to do my thing, they was fine. Do what you want. You can go there 5 days if you want.
What about you? What was your experience, academy experience? Would you ever release from an academy?
No, think.
I know that's quite a big word.
Do you know what? I only got released after. So, for instance, same thing in school. Before I went to Arsenal, I went on a couple of trials, etc.
Yeah.
So, I was offered pros at different clubs.
Yeah.
So, once again, it was more like, it's happening. Like, it's just where am I choosing to do this?
To go, okay.
Whilst being at Arsenal, my first couple of months of YT, I just wasn't enjoying it, to be honest.
Mm-hmm.
Why
do you think that was?
To be honest, I can't pinpoint it. I just think that just the way the environment was at that time, the club was more split into sections. So although we had under 17, under 19s, reserves, you had the physio room, then the first team. You weren't allowed to interact with the first team, etc. So it just felt stiff.
Okay.
So, but then at the same time, they're still expecting you to go to all the first team matches and watch them. And it was like...
Do you think then it was that sort of feeling of, if you don't interact, it will make you more hungry to want to be there?
It's an old school mentality, though, man. Of course it is. If you're around it, you want to be around it forever.
I think being in an environment like that is infectious. So if you put young people into that environment, it'll make them more hungry to want to succeed. If you're around winners,
you want to be a winner, right?
There you go. So if you give young people a snippet of this is what your life can be, give it to them, and I think then people go, actually, I want to live it. How can you ask someone to be hungry enough to go into an environment they've never been in?
I think, to be honest, they answer the question themselves, because I'm sure it's not like that now.
I'll be real with you. When I was at Chelsea, like, we used to interact with the first team all the time. We used to go out and eat lunch with them. Like the first team guys, they'll always kind of see us and, like, not trying to like name drop, and like Makalele used to pick me up and take me to training sometimes. John Terry would always interact with us.
There were a few, but once again, it was more of the English players. So whether it was Ashley Cole, Paolo Vanazza, etc., that were involved like from the youth. So they've come from where you've come from, and they're making that connection with you. Do you know what I mean? Rather than sort of your foreign players.
So let's talk about academies now. I think there's been a lot of things lately. But very sad things, I think, that saddens people. A lot of people, young people coming out of academies. And are academies doing enough to equip these young people with enough tools to succeed in life anyway? Whether that's within football or whether that's outside of football. Is it academies' job to ready them for them if they might be released? Or is it just their job to equip them with tools to try and succeed?
No, they've got to be equipped them as humans first.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, okay.
Because when they leave, you can't just... Because you can't do it for me, you're rubbish.
But do you think that's what they do?
Yeah, 100%.
That's what they do. So for you, was it when you was in that environment, was it always that you're taught to, you will succeed in this environment? You never thought about being released?
No, I didn't think about being released.
I know that's quite a negative mentality to have, because I think as a young person in the academy, why would you think about being released?
No, but it's a really, really, really realistic... Because it happens, isn't it?
It happens, yeah.
Look at the percentage.
Well, I think when you look at academies on a whole, if you look at maybe, if you're looking at a first year, to get your first year scholar or your pro, if you're in a squad of 23 and you're at a, say, let's talk about at an 18s or a 19s, how many of that 23 are going to get a pro?
That topic, so for instance, something that I guess helped me in my thought pattern is I was at Palace, I was probably about 10 or 11. Yeah. We was playing against Charlton. I scored a hat trick. The coach, I think he was academy director, I forget his name, at Palace. He's basically having a conversation with me and my dad afterwards.
Yeah.
And he's like, we've got to facilitate a team, even though you may be the only person that we actually want.
Yeah. And that's, but when you think of that realistically, you are dealing with young people, kids, and it's a cutthroat industry. But to put a fielder, do you think coaches think about that? Or do you think it's the coaches that actually believe in the young people to try and succeed? It's the people above coaches that are thinking about them conscious decisions that actually, I know he's good enough, but there's 10 other people on that pitch that aren't. So 10 other people have to play just to facilitate one player.
I think that because a lot of the time they're trying to spread themselves around because obviously at different clubs they've got different budgets, etc.
Yeah.
So you've got certain coaches dealing with all different age ranges. Mm. So at times they might not even necessarily sort of mean to pass on certain information.
Yeah.
But anxiety comes in, panic comes in. Oh, is this kid and his parents thinking about getting to another club, like whatnot? So how can we sort of entice them to stay here?
Yeah, of course. What did you say?
Yeah, and I was going to say, again, personal experience, it's like, academy, it was all cool. Like, when it went pro, that's when it became more about the money. So the kind of politics come in. And I remember having a conversation with a coach at Chelsea, and he said to me, look, George, you're on a pro. We like you down here. We rate you and all the rest of it.
Yeah.
But he said, I know you're going to want to stay here and fight for your place.
Yeah.
But he was like, it's not going to happen. And I didn't get it at the time, but it's literally, if they've paid 6 million for somebody that plays in your position, and you've come through, it doesn't really matter how good you are as a homegrown player.
Yeah.
It's like, that is now an investment that if the club doesn't get a return back on that, then it's going to be looked at as well.
And that's where it becomes a business and stops being a sport.
Exactly.
How, How does that make you feel? All three of you are homegrown. You're from here. You're brought up here. How does that make you feel? How does that make you feel for the future of, if we know now that football is no longer a sport, it's a business? What does that hold? You have to be an exceptional talent to go and mm-hmm. play in the Premier League now. It's homegrown, and when you do look at the names, you've got Callum Hudson-Odoi, you've got Phil mm-hmm. Foden. They're exceptional talents, and you've got some of them that you hear are the names, and then they disappear, and then you might see them 6 years later, come out of jail or something like that. But it's they're the ones that really interest me. Is what goes so wrong? Not for them, but how are clubs not looking after players enough to not even care about these young people? Mm-hmm. Because a lot of these young people, as we said now, are being picked up from local estates. They've got talent and things like that. And I said, I think for me, everything is repetition. If you see something every single day, you become mm-hmm. a product of your environment.
Mm-hmm, true.
So a lot of these people now, if they're not taught to act in a certain way, they're not taught what the badge should mean to you. What mm-hmm. hope has that young person got if they know they're not going to go and play first team football? When you know you could be at a club from 8 to 18 and be released at 18 and you'll never interact with that club again. For mm-hmm. 10 years of your life, you've been looked after, then to go, see you later, mate. So what do they expect these young people to do? Where do they expect them to go? Do clubs care about that?
Do clubs, the elite clubs, like
Chelsea. I can feel him next to me, you know. But and that's what I find really hard. The industry I work in now, I look at a lot of these young people and I think, how has it got to this? And obviously there's always a story behind everyone. But I look at it in football, that shouldn't be happening. There's so much money in football. It's such a business that if they're not educating young people, and I used to be one of them naive people to think there shouldn't be a plan B. You have to have a plan B.
It's greed.
You really do. And a lot of these people now being dropped out of the pro game and they're going back to local estates and have to go now change from being in that environment to a football environment to actually now readapting and going back to that environment. For me, that's not right. That doesn't sit well with me.
Here we are, go on.
Well, like I said, I can only talk from personal experience. Yeah. When, obviously I left Chelsea mutual consent because you know the situation was explained to me, whatever. And then kind of the train journey for myself.
That's what I was just about to say. Let's talk about your feelings of being at a club. Obviously, you've gone through that transition. Chelsea now are growing. You've mentioned some of the names that are there, and you must be thinking as a youngster to be part of that first team is. That's where I want to be.
Mm-hmm.
So what was your feelings like after terminating by mutual consent? What's your thought process now?
First and foremost, I was thinking, did I make the right decision? Because I didn't actually, I had another year on my deal.
Yeah.
But it's just like, you know, just being realistic and wanting to kick on with my career. That was the first thing I was thinking. Then I was kind of thinking, raw, like, man, I ain't going to play for Chelsea, bro. Like, it was heartbreaking for me. And then going back to the ends, it's kind of like, number one, everyone's looking at, I'm known as Jordan Hibbert, plays for Chelsea, like everybody.
Yeah.
So now it's like, don't play for Chelsea. Mm. But I back myself. Like, I was like, I know I'm going to get another pro.
Yeah.
But at the same time, it's kind of like, because I love the club. Like, I was there for 6 years. Like, I know everybody. And again, to survive that transition, it was kind of like, I was weighing it up in my head. I'm young. I don't really know nothing about life in football. You're kind of kept in a bubble. And then I was thinking, what's going to happen? Like, madness is happening in the ends. I'm thinking I'm going to have to go back and face all this now. Yeah. You know what I'm saying? So
I think you got to have a very strong mentality to obviously come out of a deal. A lot of young people nowadays, 90% of young people I work with, if I ask them what they're good at, they tell me nothing. And I think that's 90% of young people in general. They're not told what they're good at. They're not asked what they want to do. They're told what they have to do and things like that. So to have that mentality of, I know I'm going to get a deal, it's probably not a lot of young people will have that mentality now. And I think that shows with recent events. Did you guys ever feel like that, leaving one club thinking, is it still going to work for me? Or is this it? Was there ever that negative mentality of, this is it for me?
I was the same as Hibbo.
Yeah.
I had 2 years left and they signed, remember when I said they signed Routledge and Lennon, and I thought, you know what?
Did you know Lennon or Routledge?
Yeah,
you knew Routledge?
Both really.
You
knew both? Yeah. More Routledge. More Routledge, yeah. I just thought, I'm pissing the wind, really, because they spent proper money on these boys, so I kind of need to sort something out.
Yeah.
But I kind of wanted to get out without knowing what I was going to do next, which was the problem, because, again, I was thinking, well, is this the right decision?
Yeah.
But at the same time, I needed to get out, because it wasn't good for me. I couldn't be there any longer. Do you know what I mean? So.
Okay.
It's difficult because you don't know what you're going from everyday training, and the next day you're like, well, what do I do now?
What do I do?
Where do I, what, do you know what I mean? What do I do with my time?
Yeah. How is that? Is that a lot of panic? Did you ever feel any sort of panic or anxiety around that?
Yeah, but probably. I did at the time. I didn't think I did.
Yeah.
But probably looking back, probably. But yeah, because you're thinking, raw, like, your friends are working.
Yeah.
So they're out, or they're doing whatever they're doing, mm-hmm. and I'm just here. Like, what do I do?
Is it almost like you see when you leave one deal to another? It's you're waiting around for someone now to, obviously you've got agents and that trying to orchestrate deals and that, but is there ever that nervous feeling of, what if no one comes?
Yeah.
Do you get what I'm saying? Is one day you said you're at a club every single day training, doing well, and you're not there no more, and it's like, right, as you said, I back myself to get another club, Is there never that feeling of that club might not come?
Yeah. For me, I didn't ever think that there wouldn't be a club, if that makes sense.
Yeah.
Like I felt the belief I had in myself and my abilities, plus being at that time, I probably trained the first team a handful of times, but the players in and around, like you got Ashley Cole, you've got, as I said, Fowler Vanatsa, Jermaine Pennant, Jerome Thomas, Rowan Ricketts, you've got all these players, and you've got you're training with these players, or you're seeing these players work, like interacting with these players. So although they may not be the first team, many of them went on to have good careers.
Mm-hmm.
So the way I looked at it is, you've got other people from around the world, obviously, as well, that came into the club. Sebastian Larsson's, Johan de Giru, I can't even remember, loads of players in and around. Yeah. Player that come in, Quincy come into our team. And the way I looked at it is, well, I've scored 17 goals in our first year YT, you scored 17 goals. Well, I've played left wing as well.
Mm-hmm.
And in the big games, I've turned up.
Straight.
So 4-4-2 as well. Remember 4-4-2 them days.
4-4-2, not that fake one where you just stay up there.
Not the
fake one where you get to, you don't have to defend. Yeah, not that one. Not that one. So I'm a number 10 anyway,
yeah.
But I'm playing up front in a two, small man, big man, etc. Mm-hmm. But luckily at Arsenal, they play football, so you know the brand of football is appealing, etc. And just actually being out there and being able to deliver, I didn't have a problem with that. So as I said, I didn't think there was going to be a point where a club didn't come. End of second year, YT, didn't get a pro at Arsenal. What do I do now?
That feeling, what was that feeling like for you, not getting the pro?
I felt cheated because I felt I'd done enough.
Yeah. Do you think that's another big problem is, it doesn't matter how well you feel you've done.
Mm.
You're judged by someone else.
And
so in your head, if you know you've given absolutely everything and you feel that's enough, that might not be enough for someone else. So that feeling of giving everything and it not being enough for someone, what's that feeling like?
That feeling is, it leaves you in limbo because you also haven't been told what you can do to better yourself.
There you go. And I do think that's one of the biggest problems with the game. It's too easy to go, you know what, sorry.
Not for thank me, you, not but for no me. Thank what you. Does not for me mean?
If you,
exactly. What does that even mean?
What does it exactly
mean? What is that even? That?
Do you think feedback's a massive part of progression?
100%.
It has to be. It's selfish if you don't.
Yeah.
Because you've got the ability to help somebody and you're not doing it.
Yeah.
Why not?
So do you think that's one of the biggest problems with the English game is that a lot of young people are released with no feedback and that's why they struggle to go back into clubs. I know there's not a lot of help from clubs to get you back into football. Well, I don't know, should I say? I should ask you guys. That's the question to you guys. Is there enough done for young people at 15, 16, 17, 18? Is there enough for these young people, if they've been released from a club, to get back into the game?
One reserve appearance, under 17s, under 19s, etc. I made my first appearance for the under 17s when I was 13.
Mm.
At Palace, I'm on the bench at under 17s. Arsenal 14, scored for them, etc. Like, to do something from the age of 8 years old to, 18, you're released. They actually tried to put, like, the only club from them that came up was Boston United. Obviously, no disrespect to Boston United.
Mm-hmm. 10 leagues below, bro.
But
I've got a pressing question for Francis. Sorry.
Yeah, from my view of football
and
how I felt as a player,
mm-hmm.
I still went there, done what I needed to do. David Noble was there at the time, very, very quality player.
Mm.
Yeah, and was at Arsenal, ended up getting down to Boston United and went back up the leagues. I'm sitting in the changing room and I'm like, you got a couple other players, someone from United, someone from here, wherever, like, and you're just like, what am I doing here?
Yeah.
Like, saw David Noble, had a chat with him, etc. Like, and that, to be fair, that helped to ease me a bit, to be honest. Like, yeah. Seeing a familiar face. Being there, as I said, I'd done well, but they offered me a contract, but I felt I was better than that.
Yeah, and that's what I was going to say, is you sort of answer my question, is when you've been at these clubs, so you three have been at Arsenal, Tottenham and Chelsea. So when you're at them clubs and then you come away from them clubs, is it like, right, there's only a certain caliber of club that I'm going to? Does that make sense? So I think, Price, was it you, didn't they offer you a loan deal somewhere? And you're like, I ain't going. Yeah. Do you know what I mean?
They offered me to go to Stevenage. And at the time, I was like, absolutely not. Like, no chance. But that was me being ignorant, because I was in the bubble. And I'm like, imagine going to school, you're in school or whatever, and someone told you about Stevenage. You don't even know they are.
Right, that's what I'm... Now, let me ask
that's
you
That's your ignorance, though, from being in school.
I genuinely didn't. As much as, obviously, I love playing grassroots and you actually think about it, I came from grassroots to an academy. Mm.
Yeah.
I didn't know there was a non-league until I was about 22.
Yeah.
But that's what I was going to say is... Do you think that's a problem with young people? Is that when you're at big clubs, like you were at, you don't want to go and learn your trade at a League One or a League Two side, because you're like, hang on a minute, how do I get back from a League One or a League Two side back to where I was? Is there that sense of keeping face? Hang on a minute, as you just said, Pricey, I'm not going into school, I'm at Tottenham. We're Stevenage. Yeah, people don't even know, is Stevenage even a real team? Like, of course they are, but that lack of, actually, I'm not going down there to learn my trade. I think we're talking about No Hunger in Paradise. I think Joey Barton says, not enough young people want to go and learn their trade at a lower level because they're so worried about not being able to go back up.
That's always true, though, because look at Greenwood. Yeah. Greenwood don't have to go down there to learn his trade. Greenwood's there doing his thing. Look at Rooney.
But I think in terms of their exceptional talents, right? They're special talents. Yeah. So certain people, if we take Bamford. Bamford was at Chelsea for how long? Yeah, and had to go absolutely everywhere.
Around the houses. Same as Kane. Harry Kane, really.
And prove that he can score goals. And even when he did come back up to the Premier, he didn't really score goals. Went down to the Championship. Now he's at Leeds and he's proved that he can score goals in the Premier League. So I think he epitomises that sort of person that actually, if you're persistent and you do want to stick at it. Mm. But for you guys, was it trying to, and I mean this in the most respectful way, trying to get not a quick fix, but hang on a minute, I'm not trying to jump down to go back up because you believed in your own ability.
Should I be real with you?
Go on.
From, like, obviously, when I left Chelsea, I went to Charlton on trial. Yeah. To be fair, the deal should have been done better. It should have been going from a pro to a pro, but that's water for ducks back. Yeah. It's all cool. Charlton said, right, they're looking at me as a first team player.
Yeah.
Like, we ain't got the budget, blah, blah, just the excuses, whatever. So after that, it's just like, you just heard all the cliches. But it's just like, it's mad, I've heard it all. Yeah. But I'm saying, like, after that kind of made me think, what? Like, because I just love football. So I dropped down to the champ to go to Barnsley up north. And the realest is, like, when, like, my second year being there, I sorted myself out properly. First year, I was sleeping in a digs that was above a pub and they never had heating in the room and that. But I'm saying to myself, yo, like, for me, at that time, football was a matter of life and death because I know what block I'm from. So it's like, if I go back,
that's not
it's
an like,
I'm saying it's not an option. So I'm saying, for me personally, I know not everybody's necessarily on that, but then it boils down to how hungry are you?
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And that's what I say to the young chiefs. I'm saying, right, if you really want it, you got to do what you got to do. So I went all the way up north by myself, slept in the attic, done my thing, got my pro down there, got in the first team.
Yeah.
And then injuries, whatever. But you know, for me, it's like I said, it's about the hunger and the desire.
That's what I was gonna say. In your darkest days, so you all three of you have dealt with that word release, right? Is that from a pro game? Yeah. So dealing with that word, how do you deal with that word? Like, so in your darkest moment, what made you want to carry on being released? Was there ever a point where you're like, I'm here, like I don't want to be here, but I'm here maybe again. Like, how do you come back from their moments? Like, if you could advise young people now that are released from academies, the ASAR, and football to young people is everything. You said you might be a young boy from a local estate that has fuck all. Mum might be an alcoholic or whatnot. Going home isn't an option. But now you have no club.
Mm.
Yeah, so your world has come crashing down. What advice would you give to young people to say, you know what? You guys have been released from clubs and got other deals. What advice would you give these young people?
You want me to take that one? You want me to take that one? I'm going to be honest with you. The advice that I would give you is to just work as hard as possible. Like at the end of the day, however you look at it, some people feel, you know, they wasn't dealt a good hand. Some people feel that it was dealt a better one. At the end of the day, whatever opportunity is in front of you, you've got to decide whether to take that. And like Hib said, how hungry are you for this opportunity that you claim that you want?
Yeah.
So are you willing to go up north? Are you willing to go to another country? Because they're the things that we spoke about. Mm-hmm. Like being, you know, you've got a lot of foreign people that have come into England and they've made a good life for themselves.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
You've got a player like Jadon Sancho, he's gone abroad. Exactly. So how many people are willing to say, okay,
commitment, staying
committed, let me change, you know, what I'm doing and go to another country? Because for me, I would have loved to go to, had the ability to go to another country, to be able to play.
Commitment as well, that's being very committed. I think a lot of young people now, you ask them what commitment means, and I think commitment to them is just saying yes.
Done this Instagram thing. They want to live the lifestyle.
Young people, well, young people then, me now, me then, that was me. I never had a commitment because I didn't want to go to Stevenage.
Exactly.
I got the commitment too late when I wanted to go to Sweden.
Yeah.
By then I'd left England. Yeah. It's too late.
So, and do you know what? I think me and Viv definitely spoke about this, about young people, big talents in the UK, when it doesn't work, always seem to go, you know what, I'm going to go abroad now to sort of find a way back round and back in.
Mm-hmm.
For you, was it sort of like you've exercised all your resources here? So it's like, shit, I'm going to get on a plane to try and get back in. Or is it sort of like, hang on, before I do burn all my bridges here, let me try and go out to get away from, because sometimes the environment you're in, when you're failing, it becomes very toxic and negative. Yeah. So to try and take yourself out of that environment to go somewhere completely, and that is a big, that's a life changer, going from one country to a different country and changing your whole environment. Like for you, you done it, was that more of a reactive move than rather than being a proactive person?
Me, if, probably to be honest, it's probably to save face.
Yeah.
It was easier rather than running around going on trial and this, that and the other. I had something concrete there.
Mm-hmm.
So let me go out there, because I felt like if I was going on trial, what, say wherever, then people would be like, oh, he's a failure. Look, well, I was looking up to him at one point, and now he's coming to me here on trial. Mm-hmm. Do you know what I mean?
Yeah.
So that's how I felt. It was stupid though. That's my own ego. But at the time, that's what I felt.
Yeah.
But then going abroad, I feel like it's out of sight, out of mind. Unless you're the elite, like obviously Sancho and all that, out of sight, out of mind. Because the next best thing, you go out there, the next thing coming.
It's coming in and filling the shoes that that potentially you couldn't fill. Have all of you been abroad?
Yeah.
Where did you go, Hibba?
I was in Portugal for a year.
What was that like? In terms of like cultures, in terms of like different footballing styles and cultures, what was that like? Was it like, okay, at one point you was in England, known, big talent. Going out there, it's like, okay, now this is a totally different brand of football. How did you deal with that?
Portugal, second to Chelsea, was the best footballing experience for me.
Yeah.
Because it's like the culture out there, being in the sun every day, I was training, and then just going to the beach afterwards with the players and baking off, like I had my liquid thing out there. You get me? Like, not to say too much. Well, shout her out, special girl. So mad. But yeah, no, like, so it was patterned. Like, so to come from, again, the environment that I grew up in, to see that now, it was just like, cool. Again, it didn't quite work out because I don't think I had the right agent at the time.
Yeah.
But it's like, the experience though was just something that was life-changing for me. It opened my eyes to just the world being bigger than just the ends, do you know what I'm saying?
I want to ask another question. How much of not succeeding is down to the player? Because you mentioned, I think, agents. How much is it down to the player? You hear a lot of agents, or this agents come in and they're either trying to nick a bit more money, so it might, and obviously it filters down to you. How much is the player's fault for not succeeding?
I think if you have a certain type of career, like as in getting from academy to a first team, whether that's semi-pro, pro, what, I mean, full-time or part-time, I think you will all experience every bit of it at some point.
Mm-hmm.
So I can't say, this is 10% of that, 20% of this or whatnot, but if you keep your standards high, you're going to come across a lot of things, just like in everyday life.
True. Mm-hmm.
So you've got to understand that everything's a learning experience,
mm-hmm.
and you can get over it.
Yeah. Let's go Sunday League.
Come on.
Let's talk.
Now you're talking my language,